In this presentation, we introduce our work on the digital documentation and preservation of reconstructed pithouse architecture in Japan. Here we look at the pithouses built at the Umenoki site, a Middle Jomon settlement located in the central highlands of Japan. At the Umenoki site, we have produced photogrammetry scans of four of the five pithouses currently standing. For this presentation, we introduce our work to document the dismantling and rebuilding of one of these buildings. As a background, the Jomon are a Neolithic hunter-gatherer-fisher culture that spans over 10,000 years, up to approximately 200 BC, and the remains at the Umenoki site are from 4,500 to 4,000 years ago. Umenoki was first excavated in 2003. It was decided to preserve Umenoki as a National Historic Site in 2014, and the construction of pithouses began in 2017. Today, there are five pithouses at the site. In Japan, tens of thousands of Jomon pithouses have been excavated, yet there are few remains that positively identify their above-ground structures. Even so, there have been around 300 attempts at their reconstruction throughout the country. There are a number of design variations, and most are made with thick thatch roofs inspired by traditional farmhouses. By contrast, the designs at Umenoki draw from ethnographic examples from Native American groups, and were built with low-pitched, sod-covered roofs and a rooftop entrance. The process of reconstruction is also unique at Umenoki, where most sites contract designs to architecture historians and hire construction firms to build them. The city government that oversees Umenoki has hired a landscape specialist to collaborate with local volunteers and the site archaeologist to experimentally rebuild the pithouses. Our focus here is on pithouse number 3, first built in 2020. It was the third pithouse built at Umenoki, but the first made with the help of the resident volunteers who go by the name the Weekend Jomon Group. These volunteers are retirees who moved into this rural area following careers in Tokyo and surrounding cities. The reconstruction projects they have worked on have tried to utilize Neolithic technologies where possible, including using stone axes to fell trees and use deer antlers for digging. In early 2024, just 2 full years after the completion of pithouse number 3, it began to show signs of leaning downhill. It was assumed that this was a result of a failure to properly compact the dirt surrounding the posts, and it was decided that the Jomon group would dismantle and rebuild it. It was thought this should be a fairly straightforward process of removing and reassembling the structure, reusing the wood and other materials where possible, making repairs and collecting new materials only where necessary. Work began on June 14, 2024, and was limited to Friday and Saturday mornings. On any particular day, anywhere from 5 to 10 people participated. Outside of the group, the head archaeologist at Umenoki, Sano Takashi, joined on several occasions. The data collected for our presentation was collected by John Ertl of Keio University and Corey Noxon from Ritsumeikan University. Our research group has been researching architectural reconstruction since 2019, with work including small-scale excavations at a Jomon site near Umenoki, conducting survey work on prehistoric buildings at some 350 sites throughout Japan, and working alongside the volunteer Weekend Jomon group at Umenoki since 2022. Our research group has also created 3D photogrammetry scans of four of the buildings on three separate occasions. For this video, we introduce these scans, the process of making them, the issues that went into their production and processing, and the results of the analysis. In particular, we intended to use these scans to keep a record of the pithouse, including as a tool to record and assess the damages before their repair. The first scan of pithouse number 3 was made in May of 2022, over a year and a half after its initial completion in August of 2020. The initial scan was initially created for a separate research project involving additional pithouse scans from other sites, but the data from that project and initial scan was able to provide a baseline comparison for additional projects at Umenoki. The lower portions of the pithouse exterior was photographed using a handheld Sony mirrorless camera, while the roof was captured using the same camera on an extendable camera pole. The inside of the pithouse was poorly lit, requiring additional lighting, and the somewhat tight interior space made it difficult to capture all portions of the inside of the pithouse. A powerful ring flash was used to help illuminate the interior during the capture process. It helped to avoid additional shadows that would be difficult to avoid with fixed lighting. Normally, scaling of the Pithouses is accomplished using machine-readable scale bars, which allows the resulting models to be automatically scaled within the photogrammetry software. However, the initial scan of Pithouse number 3 was not captured using those scale bars. The model had to be scaled manually, using shared features from the final scan of Pithouse number 3 conducted before its final dismantlement. The dismantling of Pithouse number 3 took place over 6 mornings, with work limited to approximately 2 hours each day. The work began with the removal of an overlay of sticks and cedar bark used to keep the sod roof from shifting or eroding. These sticks were heavily damaged from exposure to rain and sun, and were set aside to be used for firewood. The next step was the removal of the dirt roof, which took 3 days. Much of this dirt had collected into a thick layer at the bottom of the pithouse, requiring the use of shovels and hoes and baskets to remove into 2 large piles. During construction, a waterproof membrane was added directly underneath the dirt on the pithouse, which was included to prolong the lifespan of the structure. This membrane was in surprisingly good condition and succeeded in preventing water intrusion. Underneath the tarp was a layer of bark which can be seen from the inside of the completed pithouse, and this was quickly removed by cutting the ropes that attached it to the purlins. Both the waterproof tarp and much of the bark were put into storage to be reused. After the structure of the building was revealed, the inside and surroundings were cleaned up to allow for photogrammetry scans. The 2 days of work after the scans involved 1 day to remove the purlins, most of which can be reused, and another day to remove the rafters, beams, and posts. The next scan was made on June 29, 2024. To prepare the building for photographs, the weekend Jomon group members removed the remaining dirt, waterproof tarps, and cedar bark. Benches, firewood, and other items inside the pithouse were moved outside. The cut strings that held the bark were all taken down, and finally the pithouse floors were swept and cobwebs dusted. Photographs were taken from just after noon, and it took approximately 2 hours to complete and pack up. Lessons learned. On the surface, the number 3 pithouse seemed to hold up very well over its short 3-year lifespan. The most obvious surface damage was seen in along the roofs and entryways, where exposure to the wind and sun required repairs in just over a year from its initial building. It can be understood that the damage to the other areas was mitigated by the sod covering and underlying waterproof tarp. Even after 3 years, there was no damage to the wooded structure and rope that can be seen from the inside of the pithouse. There was minor damage to the pithouse wall, which was supported by a short wattle fence. There was some decomposition of the cedar bark that lay between the tarp and dirt, with parts actively being eaten by termites. While the exposed beams, rafters, and purlins were pristine, all the wooden members that were in contact with the ground were severely decayed. The decay was so advanced that one of the posts was completely rotted through. The Jomon volunteers suspected that this was the primary culprit for the leaning building. What did the scans show, and what can we learn from them? One of the more remarked discoveries during the dismantling were the several creatures that were living in the pithouse. This includes the aforementioned termites, but also the number of ant nests feeding off the termites. Worms and other small insects were living underneath the bark that was laid on top of the ground. A mouse nest and tunnels were found on one side of the pithouse, where the mice had cut away bits of rope to make their own home. A salamander was seen in one corner of the pithouse, munching away on an inchworm that had been knocked to the floor. The most commotion was made by the discovery of dozens of grubs and beetles that were nesting inside the rotting posts and benches inside the pithouse. Most of the beetles were still inactive, and one of the volunteers pointed out that it takes about 2 years for the beetles to fully develop and leave their nests, meaning that they may have been there when the pithouse was first made. The rapid decay of the posts, rafters, and other wood in the ground was a surprise to all involved. This decay occurred despite charring the wood, which was hoped to work as a preventative measure to keep insects away. A couple of people wondered aloud whether the decision to use oak rather than the more authentic chestnut was to blame. The shock at seeing these posts rotted through spurred an impromptu lecture by the site archaeologist Sano Takashi, who explained that such decay was inevitable, and any measures would simply delay the decay, not prevent it. This nevertheless sent the volunteers on a brainstorming exercise, seeking out ways to prevent rot, whether by using concrete foundations or wrapping the posts in plastic wrap. Others simply reflected that the Jomon people must have moved around quite a bit, As the Jomon volunteer group had used up most of the appropriately sized trees from the nearby woods just after making 5 pit houses. In this and many other ways, the creation and dismantling of Neolithic architecture can provide insights that archaeological excavation is unable to provide answers to. Or rather, without engaging in this experimental building, many of the questions that have come up during this process would never be raised.